Good morning. My name's Chuck Blaisdell, and I am privileged once again to have been invited to share this pulpit this morning. And Pastor Robin and a number of our women are on the women's retreat this weekend, and we trust that they have had a powerful experience and will welcome all of them back next Sunday. You will also, if you are keenly reading your bulletin, you will notice that I am not Barbara Blaisdell. Barbara is not feeling well this morning, but she sends her love to you and wishes she could be here. And so now let me formally welcome you to First Church in Sterling, where we are gathered in the Spirit of Jesus, committed to creating heaven on earth. Welcome to all who need a church home, and for all who call this church home already. Welcome to people from all towns and cities and states and countries. Welcome to all who want to follow Christ, who have doubts and who do not believe. Welcome to people of all ages, races, nationalities, abilities, sexualities, and gender expressions. Welcome to single, partnered, and married people. Welcome to believers, to questioners, and to questioning believers. Welcome to everyone. We welcome you to come as you are and to meet this God who challenges us to be more than we think we can be. We welcome you if you are not perfect, because neither are we. We know that the church at times has rejected difference and denied God's promises for itself and for others, which is why we say without reservation, we welcome you because God welcomes you as a beloved child. We are especially delighted to see you if this is your first time, and we would like to know more about you. You'll find a welcome card in your pew, and we'd invite you to please fill that out and put it in the offering tray during the offering time. Babies, children, and youth are welcome in worship at all times, every Sunday. Their noises are joyful noises unto the Lord and remind us that the church is indeed alive. For those who desire it, we also have childcare for our babies and toddlers and Sunday school for preschool through sixth grade during church. And after church, there is donut church for our youth in 7th through 12th grade. Just a couple of announcements this morning. Our music director, Abby, starts us out.
Good morning, everyone. I just wanted to quickly announce that I am going to be meeting with the children and youth at 11 o'clock today. The children are going to come straight from Sunday school, but we're welcoming any other children or youth that are also here and would like to participate. We're going to have kind of an informal kids choir rehearsal. I'm going to teach you a song. We're going to play some instruments, and there will be stickers. So please come. We're going to be in room 2 from 11 to 11:15. Thanks.
Thank you, Abby. And Pastor Robin reminds us to, again, wear our name tags. Even those of us who have been around for many months really appreciate the reminder of names. There are indeed many opportunities for ministry and many events happening at First Church. Please like us on Facebook, and if you haven't already, because a lot of our ministry during the week happens virtually, please see your bulletin and our email list for additional written announcements. And now we deepen into worship by saying together our affirmation of faith printed in your bulletin. In the love of truth and the Spirit of Jesus, we unite for the worship of God and the service of humankind. And now let us attend to the call to worship printed in your bulletin. We belong to God. God's love and compassion is built into us.
God's mercy and hope flow through us.
Let us celebrate the powerful presence of God.
Let's rejoice in all the opportunities God gives us to serve.
Think about it.
stars above. Without it, life is wasted time. Look inside your heart, I'll look inside mine. Things look so bad everywhere. In this whole world, who is fair? We walk blind and we try to see, falling behind what we could be. Bring me a higher love. Bring me a higher love. Oh, bring me a higher love. Where's that higher love I keep thinking? Worlds are turning and we're just hanging on, facing our fear and standing out there all alone. A yearning, and it's real to me. There must be someone who's feeling for me. Things look so bad everywhere. In this whole world, who is fair? We walk blind and we try to see, falling behind in what could be. Bring me a higher
Let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now may the peace of God always be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Please turn and greet one another with signs of Christ's peace.
Would you now join me as we sing our children off to Sunday school?
Go now in peace, go now in peace. May the love of God surround you everywhere, everywhere you may go.
Good morning. So today's first reading is from the first letter to Peter. I'll be reading chapter 2, verses 9 through 10. For you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, and I'll be reading 1 through 10. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters beloved by God, that he has chosen you because our message of the gospel came to you not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit with the full conviction, just as you know what kind of people we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitations of us and of the Lord, for in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example of all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place where your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. Let the church hear what the Spirit is saying. God is still speaking.
Shining heavens rose, and I saw in the night uncountable angel stars showering sorrow and light. I saw them distant as heaven, dumb and shining and dead, and the idle stars of the night. Come down to me.
Indeed. Thank you. Beautiful, beautiful. Well, I don't usually take my wisdom from bumper stickers. I will admit there's one that I saw a long time ago that has stayed with me. And in fact, it's the title for today's sermon. That bumper sticker was both cryptic and to the point. It said simply, practice hope. Practice hope. The more I have thought about that phrase over the years, the more I think it encapsulates exactly what we Christians are called to do with our lives, our words, and our resources. At the same time, as with most bumper sticker wisdom, it also cries out for elaboration. So let us ask, what does it mean to practice hope? Well, first of all, let me offer you a definition. To practice hope is to decide with audacity to help shrink the circle of the unpicked. That's not what you're expecting. So let me repeat it. To practice hope is to decide with audacity to help shrink the circle of the unpicked. 3 points then. Decision, audaciousness, and a phrase that no doubt needs interpretation, shrink the circle of the unpicked. First of all, decision. Let us be reminded of an important, essential truth. Hope in the Christian tradition is a decision. We need to be reminded of that, for just as our culture, in the words of Barbara Blaisdell, too often lies to us about what will make us truly happy, so too does that culture lie to us about what hope is. Because hope is not simply a feeling. It's a decision. It's an act of will. But you'd never know that from the ways that the word gets used all around us, where hope is too often simply seen as a feeling that somehow overcomes you or not. Or worse, too often the culture claims that being hopeful is simply a matter of choice or taste or style, rather than being a matter of repeated conscious choice and decision. And such decision, of course, means to take personal responsibility for acting in certain ways with constancy and consistency, even when it may be the very last thing we feel like doing. When our son Andrew was in the second grade, he came home with a report card on which he had been marked down for not taking responsibility for his actions. And in the really fun parental conversation that followed that evening, out of sheer frustration, he finally blurted out, "It's not my fault that I don't take responsibility for my actions." But it was. It was. Just as it is our responsibility when we give in to the culture's constant invitation to not take responsibility and to simply and solely follow our fleeting feelings. So if we are to practice hope, we must decide that we will indeed be hopeful people and that we will indeed do hope-filled things, even when we don't feel like it. But even that isn't enough yet to get at what it means to practice hope, for there is that second characteristic of practicing hope that is required, and that is audaciousness. To talk about audaciousness, let me tell you a story. In 1869, John Wesley Powell led an expedition to map the Grand Canyon. At the time, it was completely unknown territory to the white settlers coming west. No one knew whether the Colorado River's half-mile drop in elevation from the mouth of the Grand Canyon at Lee's Ferry to its exit at the Virgin River Gorge was in a series of runnable rapids or one spectacular waterfall that would dash everyone to their deaths. No one, no white settler anyway, knew. Now today, of course, hundreds of people run the Grand Canyon in what is almost luxury. Outfitters have gourmet meals prepared each evening for life on the river. Life jacket technology makes drowning a slim possibility. And boats are designed for the very conditions that they will encounter. But in 1869, there was none of that. Just four misdesigned boats, two dozen men, none of whom had any river running experience, and only a handful of whom could actually swim. The audacity of the whole enterprise is boggling. But I want to focus on just one small story from that trip. About a month or so into their journey, Powell and one of his companions decided to climb to the rim of the Grand Canyon from the sandbar where they were camped. And so they began ascending the 1,000-plus vertical feet. Now, as challenging as that would be for any of us, for Powell it was especially so, for you see, he had only one arm. The other had been shot off in a terrible wound in the Civil War and had been amputated. And so having climbed almost to the top of the rim, Powell found himself stuck. His companion had already reached the top, but Powell was stuck a couple of feet below the rim, hanging on dearly to an outcropping in a dead-end crevasse. He couldn't go up, he couldn't go down. He was well and truly stuck, 1,000 feet above certain death and 2 feet below safety. What happened? Well, his companion above him, clad only in his by now tattered shoes and his long johns, removed his long johns, swung them over the precipice at the same time that the one-armed Powell let go of the only link he had to the earth in order to grab on to the not very savory long johns, and his companion, now naked in the desert sunshine, hauled him up to safety. I love that story. I'm amazed by that story. It is so fantastic. It displays such ingenuity. It shows such a knack for using the materials that are at hand to do what needs to be done. And it's so embarrassing and undignified. It's truly audacious. But the result was very good. We too are called to audacity. We too are called to ingenuity. We too are called to audaciously use what we have, our hearts and our minds and our passions and our creativity, our time and our talent and the contents of our wallets. We too are called to audaciously use the materials we have that have available to help haul up someone higher who is stuck. We're not called to be, as one preacher put it, folks who are passionate about moderation. No, the good and healing news that we know is too important to a hurting and hungry world for us to ever be moderate in our message. We're called to practice hope by deciding to act with audacity indeed, using all of the tools and all the materials around us to do what God is calling us to do. But do what? Remember the definition I offered? To practice hope is to decide with audacity to help shrink the circle of the unpicked. During the Jurassic era in which I attended middle school, gym classes were a little different than they are now. I never enjoyed gym. It was something to be endured. I was never very coordinated, and things that came easily to others didn't come to me at all. And the thing I absolutely hated most in gym was when the coach would appoint two captains who were almost never the wussy guys like me, but always the big macho guys who would then choose up teams for whatever game we were going to play. I remember it so vividly in the way that only middle school memories can hurt, right? I would stand there in the shrinking circle of the unpicked, fidgeting more and more, feeling more and more lost, helpless, hopeless, praying that I would at least not be the last one chosen, wishing I were somewhere, anywhere else, wondering if Scotty might choose to beam me up right now. But sometimes, miraculously, I would be picked near the first. And sometimes, even more miraculously, the coach would make me one of the captains. And then I would often try to make sure that the others in the Wuss Brigade, who were always picked last, did not have to undergo that humiliation with me. Now, of course, I realized that in my choice of teammates when I was captain, I was spiting myself more than anything else if the point was to win the game. There was a reason that I and the others were picked last. We were really bad. What's the point? It's the same point that Paul makes in what is the very earliest writing in the New Testament that we have, when he commends the Thessalonians for their work of faith and their labor of love and their steadfastness of hope. For as we have said, hope is indeed work. It is indeed decision. It is indeed an act by which we will audaciously reach out and grab onto what can get us unstuck, whatever keeps us mired in fear or resentment or cynicism. A generation later, Paul's disciple Peter made a similar point. Did you hear it? You, he writes, you are God's people. God's own people, and your job, therefore, is to proclaim the mighty acts of the God who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. For once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. My friends, once you too stood in the circle of the unpicked. Now you don't. Once you too were stuck in a dead end a few feet from safety, but now you aren't. Instead, you are here, in this place, in this community, where you have been formed and shaped by those around you who have shown you the gospel, who have picked you up when life was hard, who have thrown you a lifeline, who have believed in you when you could not believe in yourself, and who most importantly kept on reminding you, telling you, showing to you that you too have received a promise and a purpose from God. And those things made it thereby possible for you, too, to decide to practice hope. And hasn't that made all the difference in your life? Indeed. And the way that you and I can show forth our thanks is to commit ourselves to continuing to practice the very same kind of hope that we have been shown. I believe that in our gratitude, it means to care so much about those who are not part of this community, who are, in the words of Thoreau, living lives of quiet desperation, who still stand in the circle of the unpicked, that we will indeed practice hope to them. But it will take decision. For sometimes we won't feel like it. And it will take audacity. It will mean that we need to continue to make sure that everything we do speaks not just to we who are already here and know the tender mercies of God, but to those who do not. And we must have the audacity to put all our work and structure and values in the service of that goal. That's audacious, but the occasion and the opportunity demand no less. We're called to decision. We're called to audacity. We're called to shrink that circle of the unpicked in everything that we do. We're called to evoke hope. Friends, the good news this morning is that we have some wonderfully audacious dreams, don't we? We have the audacity to believe that the church is called to make a difference in a hurting world, that it can indeed help make heaven on earth. We have the audacity to think that the message of the gospel will change lives. And we have the audacity to dream of missions and ministries that we want to continue, so that we are a people who are not just interested in the difference that all of that makes in our lives, but who are passionately interested in making a difference in the lives of those who God is leading us to, lives that we do not yet know. For what God is offering us on this and every day is indeed the opportunity to do something audacious, to do something more than we thought we could, to do something more than we sometimes might even feel like doing, knowing that God has indeed, in every moment, given us the opportunity to help shrink the circle of the unpicked right at our doorsteps. May it be so. Amen.
I invite you to join me as we call ourselves to prayer, singing the hymn, "There's a River Flowing in My Soul." There's a river flowing in my soul. There's a
there's a river flowing in my
At this time in our worship service, we lift up the prayers of our people. If you have a prayer you would like this community to pray for you, please raise your hand in just a moment. And we'll come around with the microphone, and after each petition, we'll pray, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray. God, we need the strength of your hope right now. Hear now the prayers of the people as I begin with the remembrance of John Cook on the one-year anniversary of his death. He is Dennis Mulryan's brother-in-law. And now we offer our prayers.
Ask for prayers for my mother, who thankfully has been transferred from the hospital to rehab, but we're concerned that she is sometimes declining the therapy that will help her get stronger. So prayers for her.
God, in your mercy.
I have two prayers of rejoice. This is Jack's birthday weekend, so he's 15. And my second one is my daughter is applying to college today. So we're sending out 12 applications today. Please pray.
God, in your grace and mercy.
I have two brief prayers. The first is for my sister-in-law, who's been suffering for a long time but getting better. And the other is for my good friend who had a bad stroke and hopefully he's going to recover from it. He can't speak at the moment and barely can hear and see.
God, in your grace and mercy.
I'd like prayers for Alan Princeton, who just underwent heart transplant surgery yesterday. That's Joyce Shepherdson's brother.
God, in your grace and mercy.
I'd like to ask for prayers for my cousin Sandy. She just underwent surgery to remove cancer. They think they got it all. And especially prayers for her mother and family. They've already lost one sister and daughter to cancer.
Indeed. God, in your grace and mercy. God of tender mercies, we continue our prayers by acknowledging that this world can be a battering place, a bruising place, and so we have come to this sanctuary to be reminded that you have called us into the circle of the chosen, the beloved, the treasured children of God, and in turn call us to shrink the circle of the unchosen, of those who do not know they are beloved, whose circumstances belie how treasured they are in your eyes. Show us, God, the ones closest to us who need a reminder of their belovedness, and give us the right words and the kindest deeds to manifest that love. Show us, too, how we might remember people across the globe in terrible situations, not that that can help, but can make them feel unchosen, unloved, unforgotten. Help us remember and work in whatever small ways we can to change those circumstances, to find for all a place of shalom, salam, of peace. God, in your grace and mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. At this point in our service, we practice hope by making an offering of our resources that will go to indeed to the mission of this church to help create heaven on earth. And so I invite you to receive, to give that offering, and it will be gratefully received.
Thank you. fix my heart so that I may be used by thee. Lord, I'm not worthy of all these blessings. Give me a clean heart, and I'll follow thee. Give me a clean heart, so I may serve thee. Lord, fix my heart so that I may be used by thee. Lord, I'm not worthy of all these blessings. Give me a clean heart, and I'll follow. I'm not asking for the riches of this land.
I'm not asking for my friends to know my name.
But give me a clean heart so that clean heart, and I'll follow thee. Give me a clean heart, so I may serve thee. Lord, fix my heart so that worthy of all these blessings. Give me a clean heart. Give me a clean heart. Give me a clean heart.
God, we thank you for these gifts that will indeed help us to practice hope. We thank you for the way they will help make for heaven on earth. Bless each gift, bless each giver. In Christ's name, amen.
Please join me in our final hymn, number 537, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
Oh,
Now, brothers and sisters, I commend you. Decide for hope. Be audacious. Find a circle that needs to be shrunk and go for it. Amen.